Democrats demand Jeff Sessions resign, saying his decision to recuse himself from that Russia investigation is not going far enough.
I have recused myself in the matters that deal with the Trump campaign.
Also this morning, new questions about other members of Trump's team communicating with Russia.
Bitter winter blast, a deep chill moving across the country days after record heat and wind chills dropping to zero. Now the entire East Coast, nearly 150 million people bracing for the deep freeze.
Manhunt for a murderer. The search for this suspect intensifying, accused of killing those two Indiana teens on a hike. Now a former NFL star is jumping in to help, donating thousands of dollars, and he joins us live.
I wanna be a billionaire, so freaking bad.
And billionaires in a snap. 20-something tech titans behind Snapchat celebrating as their company value soars to record heights. Now each worth more than $5 billion. The secretive CEO with the supermodel fiance, a Silicon Valley darling, is he the new Mark Zuckerberg and Facebook's worst nightmare?
Live in Times Square, this is GMN with Robin Roberts, George Stephanopoulos, and Michael Strahan.
Good morning, America. Happy Friday. Boy, is it a happy Friday for those Snapchat founders. About $5 billion each this morning.
Wow. I'd be pretty happy. Right? Put in perspective, that's more than moguls like Richard Branson and also the owner of the Patriots, Bob Kraft.
But $70 billion to go to beat Bill Gates, just to put it into perspective.
Hmm. Debbie Downer this morning. I don't know. I'd be okay waking up to $5 billion.
I would too. I just say there's room for growth. And with the way my daughters use Snapchat, I think they're going to get there.
Yeah, I get it. All right.
We've got much more on that coming up. But first, let's get right to that firestorm over Attorney General Jeff Sessions. He is now recusing himself from any investigation related to the Trump campaign after reports he met with the Russian ambassador before the election. Our senior justice correspondent, Pierre Thomas, is starting us off in Washington with more on that. Good morning, Pierre.
Good morning, Amy. Sessions' close ties with Trump and the controversy surrounding those meetings with the Russian ambassador proved too much. He will no longer oversee the FBI's investigation of Russia's attack on last year's election.
Under mounting pressure from Capitol Hill, Attorney General Jeff Sessions stepping aside, saying he will have nothing to do with any investigations involving the 2016 campaign, including Russia's effort to influence the election.
I have now decided to recuse myself from any existing or future investigations of any matter relating in any way to the campaigns for President of the United States.
The decision to recuse himself coming amid reports that Sessions had met twice with the Russian ambassador during the summer before the election. One of those encounters took place at an event during the Republican National Convention, where Sessions used political funds from his re-election account to pay for his expenses, explaining he only met the ambassador in his capacity as a senator. The controversy stemming from this statement during Sessions' confirmation hearing.
I did not have communications with the Russians.
Last night on Fox, the attorney general said his testimony had been taken completely out of context.
I think it was hyped beyond reason, and I think it was unfair.
But also saying Thursday he wished he had been more precise.
And retrospect, if I should have slowed down and said, but I did meet one Russian official a couple of times, that would be the ambassador.
He removed himself despite the fact the White House said he didn't have to.
There's nothing to recuse himself. He was 100% straight with the committee.
Mr. President, should Sessions recuse himself from investigations of the Year campaign in Russia?
I don't think so at all.
Overnight, President Trump releasing a statement saying that while Sessions could have been more clear in his testimony, the Democrats were engaging in a, quote, witch hunt. But this morning, some are saying that just recusing himself is not enough. House Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi tweeting, AG Sessions' sorry attempt to explain away his perjury is totally inadequate. He must resign immediately. But Sessions and his staff maintained that his meetings with the Russian ambassador were entirely appropriate, that his answer during confirmation hearings was solely aimed at any suggestion that he was communicating with the Russians about the campaign.
Sessions said he recused himself after consulting with career attorneys at the Justice Department who recommended that he step aside, Amy.
And Pierre, the USA Today is reporting that two other Trump advisors spoke with the Russian envoy at the Republican convention this summer.
Carter Page, one of those associates, has acknowledged meeting with the Russian ambassador. Another example of contact. This explains why some investigators are so curious about so many encounters, especially given Russian is an adversary. Amy.
All right, Pierre. Thank you, George.
Okay, let's get more on this now from John Carl at the White House. Dan Abrams, our chief legal analyst, right here. And John, let me begin with you. So you got the contacts piling up, and you also have this cognitive dissonance right now. The White House appearing to disagree with their attorney general on the issue of recusal and agreeing with the Russians on the issue of this being a witch hunt.
Both the Russians and the White House have used the phrase witch hunt to describe this. And as for the ambassador, George, at some point you get to wondering who didn't meet with the Russian ambassador on this campaign. Now, these contacts may have been fine. There may have been no problem with them. But the bottom line is we have been asking the question for weeks over and over again, who on the Trump team had contacts with the Russians. And we learn more and more as we go along. This investigation truly is just getting started.
Even though they've had denials of that about 20, 21 times. Dan Abrams, this issue of whether or not the attorney general was straight with the committee during the confirmation, the bar for perjury, very high.
Right, let's separate out political from legal. Wrong or inaccurate is not perjury. To get a perjury conviction, you need willful, you need intentional. He has to have done it on purpose. And regardless of what you think about why he did it, how he said it, proving that he did it on purpose would be nearly impossible based on what we know right now. So I think it is beyond unlikely that there's going to be a perjury indictment. And you know, it's not that dissimilar to what we talked about in the context of the Hillary Clinton email investigation, which is wrong doesn't make it criminal.
But the question is has he done enough now by recusing himself? So will this put the damper on any other calls for independent investigation?
No, I think it's actually going to increase it. Why? Because now you have another official who is apparently having conversations with the Russians, and as a result, typically it would be the attorney general who would call for a special counsel. Now you're talking about a deputy attorney general or an acting deputy attorney general who will make the decision about whether to call for a special counsel. Special counsel would then investigate more broadly than just about Sessions. That's going to be the big question in my mind, which is, will this administration appoint a special counsel to investigate beyond just Congress and the FBI and the investigation?
And right now they're holding the line. Meanwhile, John, on another front, Indianapolis papers reporting yesterday that Vice President Mike Pence, when he was governor of Indiana, used a private email account for government business.
Yeah, just as he was criticizing, and the Republicans are criticizing Hillary Clinton quite strongly for her use of private email. Now, George, there are some significant differences here. Pence was using an AOL account. He didn't have a private server. He wasn't dealing with classified information. There's no Indiana law that says you cannot use private email as a government official, whereas at the State Department there was a policy that suggested that for sensitive information. But it certainly doesn't look very good that at the very time they were hammering Hillary Clinton over private email, the governor was using private email.
Okay, John Carl, Dan Abrams, thanks very much.
All right, and now to the rapidly intensifying battle with Al-Qaeda. The Pentagon confirming to ABC News just moments ago there was another new round of airstrikes in Yemen overnight following that January raid that killed Navy SEAL Ryan Owens. ABC's chief investigative correspondent Brian Ross is here with that new reporting. Good morning, Brian.
Well, good morning, Amy. For U.S. Navy SEALs and the Army's Delta Force, this is not what they call go time. Commandos being told to expect much more action against Al-Qaeda in Yemen following the 20 new airstrikes on Thursday and now the new ones overnight.
These photos were posted on Twitter overnight from Yemen, described by local residents as a new U.S. military operation. U.S. military special operations personnel tell ABC News that commandos based in the region have been told to expect a lot more action against suspected terror targets under the Trump administration. Not deterred, they say, by the loss of a U.S. Navy SEAL in a raid on this suspected terror compound in Yemen in January, and possibly the deaths of many civilians. Local residents showed pictures of a $75 million U.S. aircraft that was abandoned and purposely destroyed in the operation. But U.S. officials continue to maintain that what happened here was a success based on documents discovered in computers and phones seized in the raid, including, officials tell ABC News, what they are calling a global address book of Al-Qaeda operatives. President Trump alluded to it all in his speech before Congress after introducing the widow of the dead SEAL, Ryan Owens.
I just spoke to our great General Mattis just now, who reconfirmed that, and I quote, Ryan was a part of a highly successful raid that generated large amounts of vital intelligence that will lead to many more victories in the future against our enemy.
The Al-Qaeda group in Yemen is considered the terror group most likely to carry out an organized attack against the U.S. or U.S. aircraft. Its master bomb maker has long been a top priority target for the U.S., but there's no indication so far that these latest raids or airstrikes did anything to take him out, George.
Boy, that was really something. Yeah. They are intensifying right
Absolutely,
now.
Absolutely.
Thanks, Brian. Back here at home, healthcare battle heating up on Capitol Hill as GOP leaders try to unite around a plan to repeal and replace Obamacare. They're being hit by Democrats and some Republicans for keeping their plan secret under lock and key. Our congressional correspondent Mary Bruce tracking the search. So Mary, what's going on here and what do we know about the new bill?
Yeah, George, 20 million Americans are waiting to see what's going to happen with their coverage. And now there's a new draft to overhaul Obamacare and a bit of a new fight to go along with it. House Republicans are keeping this new draft under wraps for now as they make revisions. But that is not sitting well with Democrats who are eager to see what they're up against and even some Republicans who opposed an earlier version. Now, Senator Rand Paul is blasting the secrecy. And yesterday he went on a bit of a public hunting expedition here, going through the basement of the Capitol, trying to see if he could find this document, but he says it's being held like a national secret. And even Leader Pelosi offering to help out with his hunt, tweeting that she would be willing to release the hounds. George.
Yeah, they are going after, and they're trying, they have to keep it secret because they know the trade-offs are tough here. And once the details get out, it's going to anger and rage one faction or another.
Absolutely. And House Republicans here are simply being extra cautious, especially after an earlier version leaked and then was met with some pretty swift opposition. So for now, just the Republicans on this House committee that are drafting the bill are able to see it. But George, that could change soon. They're expecting to bring it up for consideration next week.
Yeah, they want to get this all done by Easter.
All right, let's bring in Matt Dowd to talk about this. The original Affordable Care Act was also drafted in secrecy. But how often does this sort of thing happen?
This whole thing reminds me of like the Highlight magazine your kids do, which is like find the hidden picture as you go around this. It's not unusual for these things to be drafted confidentially and done in a way that it's not totally shared with any. It is very unusual that members of your own party who want to see it, they won't show it to you. That's an unusual part of this.
All right, let's talk about President Trump's week. Started off with a high note with the speech. Now we've got the session situation where he recused himself. How should the Trump administration be handling this big turn in events?
Well, if you took a strategy of how not to handle it, they've done the strategy of how not to handle this. First, they have to tell the truth and be honest. That's the overall arching thing. I kind of looked at this like a traffic light strategy, which is green, go ahead and get all of the information out there as quickly as possible and don't let the press drip, drip, drip this. Yellow, caution. Use your words correctly, concisely in this, and don't parse. If you're parsing, you're losing. And finally, red, stop. Stop using the word witch hunt. The last time the witch hunt was wrong was in Salem, Massachusetts. So in this case, usually when a witch hunt, there's a witch around.
So it seems like on all three of your points, the White House going in the opposite direction. Do you think they're going to be able to hold the line against these other investigations?
No. I think this is full scale. Where there's smoke and where there's a lot of smoke, there's fire. Everybody knows it. Even when you talk to Republicans in the course of this, they know that there's a problem here. They're going to have to figure out a way to clear it up and clean it up as fast as they can. And the other thing, the Russian ambassador, I have to say, feels like the Forrest Gump of Donald Trump. It's everywhere there is something going on, the Russian ambassador seems to be pictured there.
Sounds like he's doing his job.
There's a lot to talk about, and George is going to have much more on this week on this Sunday right here on ABC. Michael?
All right. Thank you, Amy. We're going to turn now to the wild weather that's across the country, from record highs and tornadoes to a new bitter cold blast. And thank goodness, it's hard to keep up with it, that Ginger Z is here. You're the only one, I think, who can organize all this for us, Ginger.
Well, I will. I'll do just that, because when you go from 70 to 20 and you're talking temperature, you're going to have wind, big wind, gusts up to 60 miles per hour, taking out that school bus. Thankfully, everybody okay. We've got pictures like that all the way to North Carolina. This morning, though, a place like Cleveland, Ohio, that was 77 a week ago today, waking up with snow. That lake effect snow could go up to 8 inches, and they feel like 13. The wind chill is in place. The freeze warning stretch all the way down to Georgia, up to Maine. The cold blast is here, at least for the weekend, guys. I'll have another warm-up coming in just moments, so please don't go anywhere.
We're not going anywhere. Don't worry about that. Thanks, Ginger. We're going to get the latest now on parents seeking justice in Georgia after their son was killed during an encounter with police. A newly released dash cam video appears to be strengthening their case. ABC's Steve Osunsami is tracking it from Atlanta. Good morning, Steve.
Good morning to you, George. Authorities aren't commenting while the district attorney decides if there'll be charges filed against the officers. In this newly released police video, you first see the chase. We should warn you, the video is disturbing.
That's the pickup truck driven by 18-year-old Nicholas Dykstra, running from police an hour and a half south of Atlanta. He crashes into a ditch, and now sheriff's deputies are trying to get him to leave the vehicle. He hits the gas again, but he's stuck. Police then drag him out of the passenger side door. This morning, his family admits that he was on drugs, but they feel what happens next is murder.
Tased him several times, pulled him from the vehicle, put him in the road, and got on top of him.
You see it clearly. One of the deputies keeps leaning his knee onto their son's neck and then turns him around and does it again. A state autopsy says it's one of the reasons he died, from compression of the neck and torso.
He still up? Turn him on the side. Hey, Nicholas, wake up.
The family says police waited too long to give their son CPR.
Yeah, EPA for him, so we're not getting any calls on him.
They are suing.
He hadn't committed a crime, and they killed him. And I got a problem with that. And they should be held accountable.
The deputy with the knee was fired after being criminally charged in a separate case. The other three this morning are on regular duty.
The family says their son was struggling with addiction and shouldn't have run from police in 2015, but they say that was no reason for him to die. Amy.
All right, Steve Osunsami, thank you. A consumer alert this morning. The CDC sounding the alarm about an E. coli outbreak across several states. The CDC says the likely source of the outbreak is I Am Healthy brand soy nut butter products. If you have these products, it is recommended that you do not eat or serve them. The outbreak has so far affected at least a dozen people, and we're expected to learn today which states are affected. Michael.
All right, Amy, and turning now a little lighter subject. Former president who's back in the spotlight, George W. Bush, has been on tour talking about his new book of paintings, and he stopped by Jimmy Kimmel last night and had some funny stuff to say. Take a look.
When your vice president, Dick Cheney, when he shot that guy in the face, did it ever seem funny at all to you?
Well, every time Cheney would come in, a lot of people would yell, duck.
Were you jealous of the size of the crowds at Trump's inauguration?
I was there.
I know you were there.
I was the guy trying to put the
he tried to put the poncho
the
on
poncho.
It. Yeah, we noticed that, yeah. Actually. Yeah. How are your parents doing, by
Thank
the way?
Thank you for asking. They're doing great.
They're doing, I bet people are asking that all the time.
Yeah. You know, when he came out to flip the coin at the Super Bowl, it was a very joyful moment.
I would imagine so. I think it was for the whole country, really, to see him doing
that.
Yeah,
he's a great guy.
And I can't help but feel like maybe he was faking it a little just so he didn't have to go to the inauguration. Yes?
He's no dummy.
Well, he got a real laugh out of the president there.
And I love to see that natural laugh out of him. He talked about also the first time he went to the White House, the 1969, pulled up in his purple Gremlin to take Richard Nixon's daughter, Tricia, on a date.
What?
That was set up by his dad. Oh, yeah. Talking about pressure.
The things you learn on Kimmel.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, let's go back over to Ginger.
Hey, and this could end up being, in Washington, D.C., the earliest cherry blossom bloom on record. Still waiting to see if that happens, because we've been so warm, but this morning, not warm. Feels like 19. The actual air temperature in D.C. is 35. We'll warm right back up, though. Your local weather in 30 seconds. First, though, the weekend getaways brought to you by Liberty Mutual Insurance.
Liberty Mutual stood with me when I was too busy with the kids to get a repair estimate.
Liberty did what?
Yeah, with Liberty Mutual, all I needed to do to get an estimate was snap a photo of the damage and voila.
Voila.
I wish my insurance company had that. Wait, hold it. Hold it, boys. It's supposed to be three of you. Where's your brother? Hey, where's Charlie?
You can leave worry behind when Liberty stands with you. Liberty stands with you. Liberty Mutual Insurance.
Fast-moving weather system will bring the cold. It will also bring a few scattered snow showers. Today's high, just 42 degrees. Tomorrow, we're right at 40 degrees with wind chills, though, that will start out in the teens. This will be one cold weekend for sure. We've had very few days that have felt like that. Look at next weekend, though, 61 to 66. Saturday, Sunday could be looking at a significant weather system with rain and wind as we get ready to spring forward.